Hi, Mitch Winger back with another video on data analytics and machine learning. In this video, we'll discuss how to understand what we get from clustering. Hope you enjoy. Okay, let's get started. So now we've created some clusters. Clusters are cool. Now what? Recall that our clustering result is either a group of cluster definitions, i.e., what is the cluster centroid, or a dendrogram, and the set of data points for each cluster. So how can we understand these results? This is extremely important because we often use clustering in exploratory analysis. The whole idea is to see whether we've discovered something. The nature of your data will certainly play a role in how you develop an understanding of your clusters. There are a few approaches that work in many situations. If we get back to thinking about our beverages, you know, our coffees, our beers, our wines, our liquors, we had a number of attributes that we could put together for each type of beverage. But we also have names of the beverages. In many cases, the name of a particular brand or a particular beverage is well known enough among aficionados that that becomes meaningful. Or we may have specific types, lager or porter, that would be also meaningful. That name or that type itself gives us a lot of information. We may even identify a well-known exemplar in each cluster to serve as a representative for that cluster. So if I wanted to represent Pilsners, I could say Pilsner Urquell. This works in situations, as you might imagine, where people are already familiar with that exemplar for each cluster, but of course it won't work so well if that's not the case. You can also rely on experts to provide additional descriptors for that cluster. But on the other hand, if you think about it, you already have a whole range of attributes that you used to help build these clusters. As you explore these clusters, you can see which attributes are stronger in some clusters and weaker in others. This exploration can lead you to creating your own descriptions or explanations for each cluster and what accounts for membership in that cluster. In situations dealing with textual information, like news stories, for example, the exemplar can provide a title that gives your user a feel for the nature of that cluster. So keep the nature of the data and the nature of the users in mind when considering how to describe your clusters. One of the interesting things about hierarchical clustering is that it doesn't just give us a set of clusters, it also gives us several ways we can create clusters from a single approach. If you'll recall that dendrogram, you've got some flexibility there in determining how many clusters you'd like to see for any particular application. If you cut the dendrogram off at different places in the hierarchy, you could just say, well, I want to see 2 clusters, or 3 clusters, or 5 or more clusters. This is one advantage of hierarchical clustering that makes it worth considering. No matter how you create your clusters, you end up with a set of clusters and a list of which data points belong to which cluster. Now, you can designate the cluster centroid as an exemplar, like we talked about, the typical member of that cluster, to describe the average cluster member. If you have a lot of attributes, the description of that centroid point can be quite detailed. Instead, it might be better to focus on those attributes that actually differentiate this cluster from other clusters. So at this point, we're actually starting to think in terms of supervised learning, and we could start to apply those methods here. To start with, we could use the cluster names as the label. And that label, of course, is our target attribute. Each example now has that label attribute added to its feature vector, and we can now use classification algorithms on the data. We can use the resulting equations, decision trees, or whatever to help us develop a good description for each cluster. Keep in mind that you want to focus on the unique aspects of each cluster, what differentiates it from other clusters. Also remember, at this point, you now have a classification problem that you can attack with multiple supervised learning methods. And because tree-based approaches are generally pretty easy to explain and describe, tree-based approaches tend to work well here to determine what are the most important characteristics that make data points members of particular clusters. We're now starting to see a broader view of how a full-fledged data science project works. Now, clustering, of course, is different from predictive techniques, but they're both useful in a data mining context. Predictive models are used once we've clearly defined a specific business problem, while clustering models help us understand our data and develop new questions, which hopefully we will be able to develop into specific business problems some point down the road. Of course, not all business issues start out as well-defined problems. Consider the problem of fraudulent transactions within a company. We've got some indicators that we can use, but there is a long way to go with respect to machine learning. Fraud can be committed a lot of different ways, and the more sophisticated fraudsters will try to make their fraudulent activity look as legitimate as possible. And that's where the understanding cycle comes into play. Exploratory work is done here until we can develop a more precise definition of the problem. There may be many iterations through this phase as we learn more and more about the data and the business. Today, all companies should spend some time and effort, basically an R&D type effort, exploring their data, seeing what they have, and identifying new business problems that they may be able to use their data to solve. Unsupervised learning helps here as we learn more about our data and possibly begin to collect additional attributes for analysis. As it so happens, even though we frequently describe certain techniques as being supervised techniques, almost every technique we've discussed and will discuss in this course and throughout data science can be used for data exploration as well. Now, in CRISP-DM, as you can see, what happens in these projects is that when time has been spent formulating the problem precisely, then the modeling and testing tend to be fairly straightforward. We have an objective measure we can use to determine our success. When we just have a vague idea of what it is we want to do, we have to spend a lot more time going back and forth in the business data understanding phases. Even then, the problem may not fully come into focus, resulting in additional modeling and evaluation effort. It's important to resist the urge to rush to a precise business problem. This can prevent important discoveries, and also it can result in a forced solution that really doesn't help as much as you'd like it to. Clustering is powerful too, but it can be difficult to understand what those clusters mean. As a matter of fact, it's possible that there's no actionable meaning in any particular clustering solution. So creativity and solid domain knowledge are critical as you're bouncing back and forth between data understanding, modeling, evaluation, and business understanding. And this cycle can happen many, many times before you uncover something. However, this creativity can yield real results. GE Capital was able to bring some researchers in, and they were able to analyze credit card customer data and develop 5 clusters using their clustering techniques. And that allowed them, once they had reviewed those 5 clusters, and this took quite some time to complete the process, this ended up with a new predictive model where they could use the attributes that we know at the time of credit card application to predict how profitable or how risky potential new customers would be. So they were able to extend different credit lines, different rates, and so forth, much like Capital One did in the case study we discussed earlier. That's it for this presentation on understanding your clustering results. I hope you found it informative. Be sure to check out the other videos in this series.